Hello everyone, and welcome to Lecture 1 of our Introduction to Causal Inference in Epidemiology course. This lecture will be structured in 4 videos. In the first one, we will define what potential outcomes are and use them to understand the fundamental problem of causal inference. In the second video, we will define average causal effects, also known as aggregated causal effects. And those will be the type of causal effect that we will try to estimate throughout the course. The third part of the lecture is really important, because in that part we will discuss the required conditions for estimating causal effects. In other words, what must happen or what must we assume to be true for us to be able to estimate causal effects. And in the fourth and final video of this lecture, I will provide a brief summary of the main concepts developed throughout the lecture. And my idea is that you can use this sort of as a checklist for you to make sure that you have all main concepts down before moving forward to lecture 2. So to start off our discussion, I would like us to consider a very simple example. Suppose that Fernando, myself, had a headache 1 hour before class. You know, too much stress, too much work preparing lectures, recording lectures, so I ended up having a headache. I had a headache, and for that reason, I decided to take an aspirin. After minutes after I did that, my headache was gone. So a very simple situation here. Based solely on the information provided here on the screen, can we say with 100% certainty that taking aspirin caused the headache to go away? Guys, notice we have two events: taking aspirin and the headache status. Can we attribute the change in the headache status to the fact that I took an aspirin? That will be a type of causal question. And throughout this course, we want to know how to ask causal questions and also learn ways to try to answer them. And on that note, we could also ask ourselves, what sort of information do we need to be certain that one event is causally related to the other? Let's think about that considering our aspirin example. If the information provided here on the screen is not sufficient for us to be sure that taking aspirin affected the headache status, what sort of additional information would be required for us to be able to do so? And indeed, we could ask ourselves even more basic and fundamental questions, such as, what do we mean by causal effect? It is obviously important when we study causal inference to know what we mean by causal effects, that is, to have a proper definition of causal effects. I expect that many of you are looking forward to learning methods for estimating causal effects, but at this stage it is important for us to think about those more conceptual and perhaps even philosophical questions about causation, so we can have a better understanding of what causality is all about. Developing our aspirin example a little bit further, we can note that we have an observed or factual situation. That observed or factual situation is simply what we observed to have happened. In our example, we know that Fernando took the aspirin and that his headache went away. We just observed this happening and we know this to be true. But now let's suppose that we also know that in case Fernando had not taken aspirin, his headache would not have gone away. Notice the language I'm using here, guys, in this sentence. I'm using a language conveying the idea that this situation is unknown. All we can do is wonder what would have happened had such situation occurred, but we cannot do more than that. We cannot actually know what would have happened because this situation is not observed. We can also say it is a contrary to fact or counterfactual situation. For now, we will assume that we know what would have happened in this counterfactual situation. But please keep in mind that in practice, we will never know that, and this will be very important later on. But again, going back to the situation where we know both the outcome under the factual situation and the outcome under the counterfactual situation, it is rather intuitive to conclude that aspirin had a causal effect on Fernando's headache status, because we can compare the outcome under the two situations. The observed outcome, the outcome when Fernando took the aspirin, and the counterfactual outcome, the outcome in the situation where Fernando did not take the aspirin. And because the outcome differs, in one situation the headache goes away and in the other one it doesn't, we can conclude that taking aspirin had a causal effect on Fernando's headache status in this situation. So now we are in a good position to define what potential outcomes are. Going back to our example, guys, notice that we have two actions. Action 1, taking aspirin, and action 2, not taking aspirin. And both situations, both actions are in principle possible. We have two possible actions, so we have two potential outcomes. In our example, those two potential outcomes are Fernando's headache status in case he takes the aspirin, and Fernando's headache status in case Fernando does not take the aspirin. So, simply Fernando's outcome for each one of our possible actions. Notice, guys, that before the action happens, that is, before Fernando decides to take the aspirin or not, both outcomes are possible, because Fernando can take the aspirin, and in that case, his headache status under the situation where he took aspirin will be observed. Or if Fernando decides not to take the aspirin, Fernando's headache status in case he does not take the aspirin will be observed. And therefore we have the name potential outcomes, because in principle both of them are possible. However, this changes after the action happens. After the action happens, one of the potential outcomes becomes observed and the other potential outcome becomes a counterfactual outcome. The potential outcome that becomes the observed outcome is the potential outcome that corresponds to the action that happened. We could perhaps say that the fact that a specific action took place, the potential outcome that corresponds to that action gets realized and becomes observed. However, any other outcome that does not correspond to the action that actually happened will become counterfactual. Because observing this outcome would require that things had happened in a way that they didn't. For the purposes of our course, we will only consider a binary exposure or treatment variable, which we will call X. And we will use the following notation. X equals 0 corresponds to the unexposed status, and X equals 1 corresponds to the exposed status. So, for example, if exposure is taking aspirin, then taking aspirin corresponds to X equals 1, and not taking aspirin corresponds to X equals 0. Let us also consider a binary outcome or response variable, which we will call Y, and we will use the following notation. To denote outcome failure, we will use Y equals 0, and to denote outcome success, we will use Y equals 1. And in our example, the outcome is headache, so outcome success is having headache, and failure is no headache. Notice, guys, that this language of failure and success does not necessarily correspond to a desirable or undesirable outcome. For example, if the outcome is death, then success would be dying and failure would be surviving. Of course, opposite to what would be desirable. So this is really a definitional issue that's arbitrary and can be defined according to one's preferences. Notice, guys, that Y here is the observed outcome. We will use a slightly different notation to denote potential outcomes, so we can specifically refer to observed or potential outcomes, and the notation would be the following. Y superscript X equals 0, or Y superscript 0, or simply Y 0, to simplify my speech, will denote the potential outcome under non-exposure, while Y 1 will denote the potential outcome under exposure. Let's try to apply the notation we just defined to our aspirin example. So in Fernando's case, the action that happened was taking aspirin. Therefore, the action that happened corresponds to X equals 1, and the action that did not happen, the counterfactual action, is X equals 0. Moreover, in Fernando's case, the observed outcome, not talking about potential outcomes here, guys, just the observed outcome, was headache went away, that is, no headache. So, in Fernando's case, Y equals 0. Let's think about the relationship between potential outcomes and the observed outcome. In Fernando's case, Fernando took an aspirin, right? and Fernando had an observed outcome. So Fernando's observed outcome is his outcome under the situation where Fernando took the aspirin, right? Because he took the aspirin. So what we observed corresponds to the action that happened, and the action that happened was taking aspirin. But that outcome is just the potential outcome under exposure. That is the potential outcome in the situation where Fernando takes the aspirin. Therefore, we can say that Fernando's potential outcome under exposure, that is Y1 equals Y, which in this case equals 0. However, what about Y0? That is, what about Fernando's potential outcome under non-exposure? We don't know that, because this outcome would only be observed hadn't Fernando taken aspirin, but he did take the aspirin. So this outcome could only be observed in a counterfactual situation. This is a counterfactual outcome. And because it is counterfactual, it cannot be observed. And the conclusion here, guys, is that the observed data do not provide information on both potential outcomes, because one of them is counterfactual. We only observe one of the potential outcomes, but the other one remains unobserved because it is counterfactual. Let's try to consolidate our understanding on the relationship between observed and potential outcomes. For all exposed individuals, that is, for all individuals for which x equals 1, we can say that their observed outcome equals their potential outcome under exposure, that is y1. While for all individuals unexposed, that is for individuals for which x equals 0, their observed outcome equals their potential outcome under non-exposure, that is y0. So we could summarize this conclusion in this table here, where we have the potential outcome, the actual exposure, and the type of potential outcome you're talking about. So we can see here that when the exposure that the potential outcome makes reference to equals the actual exposure of the individual, then the potential outcome will be observed. And we can see this both for Y0 and Y1 here at the bottom of the table. However, the two middle rows here show situations where the exposure value that the potential outcome makes reference to differs from the actual exposure. So those potential outcomes will be counterfactual or non-observed. So now we can finally use our knowledge on potential outcomes to define our very first type of causal effect, and that will be the individual level causal effect, which we can define as the difference between two potential outcomes. So the individual level causal effect equals the potential outcome under exposure minus the potential outcome under non-exposure, or Y1 minus Y0. In our aspirin example, this will be the causal effect of taking aspirin on Fernando's headache status, which equals Fernando's headache status in case he takes aspirin, which is Fernando's Y1, Fernando's headache status in case he does not take the aspirin, which will be Fernando's Y0, and in our example, those values are 0, 1, and 0 minus 1 equals negative 1. So that will be the individual level causal effect in Fernando. The negative value here simply indicates that the exposure prevented the outcome from happening or caused outcome failure. The last thing I wanted to talk about in this part of the lecture is the fundamental problem of causal inference, which, as the name suggests, is a very important topic when we study causal inference. And indeed, it's not only the name, this concept is crucial for us to understand why we do many of the things we do when you try to estimate causal effects. It should be clear by now that comparing potential outcomes is limited by missing data. Let's try to develop this idea a little bit further. We just learned that individual level causal effect is defined based on both potential outcomes. That's because we compare Y1 with Y0, so we need to know both potential outcomes for us to be able to calculate the individual level causal effect. However, we also learned that actual data, that is, data that can be obtained in real life, can only provide information for one of these outcomes, because only one of the potential outcomes corresponds to the action that actually happened. The other one will be counterfactual. Therefore, we will never know both potential outcomes, which implies that there is insufficient data for estimating causal effects. The sad conclusion here, guys, is that it is impossible for us to estimate causal effects with certainty based only on observable data. And that's the fundamental problem of causal inference. It is essentially a missing data problem with regards to the potential outcomes. So at this point, some of you might be thinking, okay, that's it, causal inference is doomed, let's try to do something else. However, I would encourage you to stick with the course for a little longer, because throughout the course, we will learn strategies to try to overcome this issue. We'll go back to the fundamental problem of causal inference in part 3 of this lecture, when we will discuss the required conditions for estimating causal effects. But in part 2, we will continue to assume that we know both potential outcomes, so we can define average or aggregated causal effects. That's it for this video, guys. I hope you find it useful. I hope the content was clear. Please let me know if you have any questions, comments, critics in the comment section down below. Thanks for watching, and I see you in part 2.